excited to be with you guys. Hey, nice to see you.
You too, brother.
So I think what we'll do is we'll start with some prayer requests as you all are kind of settling in. And we're going to be looking at Psalm 120. And we're excited about this. And I've been actually last week putting this together, and I shared a little bit Monday night with some people that I was with. And I was so excited, and so I feel like I've really had a lot of time to study on this particular psalm. And this morning it hit me that I just felt really unorganized with it. So you're going to probably see a best organized psalm and very unorganized. So so maybe it'll come out come across better organized than I think. So we'll see. We're going to pray, though. Any prayer requests that people have as we're kind of still kind of getting in? People are sort of gathering in. Yeah, please.
Terry Jones.
Okay.
Got a heart condition. He's on the way to the hospital.
Oh, okay.
This morning.
So we want to pray for Sherry. Yeah, absolutely. Thank you.
Sherry
Jones.
Sherry or Barry?
Sherry.
Sherry.
Yeah.
Okay. Sherry. Her husband had this morning.
Yeah, that's been a while back. She's on the way this morning.
Oh, wow.
The heart was on the way.
Is this your name?
No.
Okay.
Okay, so we want to pray for that. You can pray for Marcy. She's with our granddaughters this morning. Everything's okay, but Nathan is being called out, or at least may be called out. High probability for APD, so he's on the police force, and you know, they've been having situations in Albuquerque, so we just, if y'all could pray for the APD, those that are on the front line, our first responders, be good. Yeah, so pray for that, and Lord willing, if he doesn't get called out, we'll get to see him this afternoon. He's bringing the girls up. Marcy as well. She's one of the girls. And she's be brought up to Cedar Crest, so I'll get to see my wife. She didn't get to see her last night. She's not tonight with them because he could have been called out. I don't know. I don't know if he was or not. So any other prayer requests? Well, thank you all for being here. Let's pray. Let's ask God's blessing. Father, thank you for just the opportunity to be together. Lord, it's such a blessing. I was thinking about this today, Lord. Earlier this morning, what a unique thing the church is. What a unique thing that you have birthed, Lord, through faith, and that we can gather together, we can be the brothers and sisters across the globe worshiping you. And Lord, we worship the same God. We follow the same Bible. What a unique thing. Father, that your Spirit is in all these places and your Spirit guides us. So, Father, we're just so grateful for what you are doing. And Father, this unique ecclesia, this church that you've birthed us into. Father, we want to lift up Sherry this morning. Now, we pray for her. We ask God that you would be with her as she's going to the hospital. And Lord, we know you're in control. That you ordain all the events of our life. And we pray that your Spirit would be with Sherry, that you'd strengthen her right now. God, that your hand might even touch her and just strengthen her heart, God. This heart attack that she's got, or this heart problem. And we just ask that you'd intervene and you'd strengthen her. And Father, give Perry encouragement for his wife as well. He's probably right there with her. We pray, Father, that Perry would be just a real rock. He'd be an encouragement. He would just be in prayer, and you would bless both of them, Lord, with your presence right now. And Father, we pray for the doctors that are going to see Sherry, Lord, that you give them wisdom. Lord, just help them to make good decisions. And just use this for your glory, Lord. So, Father, we just so blessed to be able to pray. Thank you, Lord, that you, there's nothing beyond your ability, nothing too hard for you. Father, we also want to pray for Nathan and ask that you would bless really all the first responders. Lord, the Albuquerque Police Department. Father, give Mayor Keller, the commander of the police department, wisdom. And Father, we pray for your protection for those men and women. And that, Father, that there would be peace in Albuquerque, God.
Yes.
You would just come down and touch hearts and bring peace there. So, Lord, we just commit that to you. We pray, Father, for the governor of New Mexico as well, Lord, that you give Mrs. Lujan Grisham a wisdom, a heart that would follow after you, Lord, that she would really seek you in the situation. And Father, we just ask, Father, that you would bless the service ahead as we think and as we prepare ourselves. Father, that's kind of what this psalm is all about, preparing ourselves for worship. And Father, we pray that you would bless this time. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, Greg. Yeah, thank you so much. So we're going to click through. This is really starting the Psalms of Ascent. And sometimes this is referred to, as you look in your Bibles, as Psalms of Degrees. So there's 15 psalms that are just kind of loaded in there, 120 to 134. And it's curious, you know, probably you have wondered, I have wondered, what does it mean that these are psalms of ascent? Does it mean that we're going higher, closer to God as we worship him? Does each psalm kind of take us to a new level? Are there levels? You know, that's a good question. Are there levels of psalms? And so we're going to kind of look at that. I've done quite a bit of reading on it. And so I'll try to relate to you what I've learned. And I believe, you know, that we're in for a real treat as we look at the Psalms of Ascent. How many of you guys know that God's Word is a treat? It's food for our soul, isn't it? So we're in for a treat. We're in for some real feeding, I believe, as we look at these psalms. So go ahead and see if that'll advance. That's an excellent. So there's 15 of these psalms, and it's up there kind of on the top. And these psalms are all designed for singing. You can see there's sort of a cadence, and it's a poetry. It's kind of in a poetry form. And so there's, for you that are musicians, worship leaders, this is one of these psalms that's really, that Israel used apparently for worship, okay? And so there's an interpretation that several have made that, you know, there's 15 steps on the temple that go from the outer court into the inner court, Solomon's temple. And so it's thought that, you know, they would sing one of the psalms on each step as they went up into the temple. That's now there's no account that they actually did that. There's nothing that's written that's a historical record that the priest did that. But it's thought they might have done that. There, you know, it doesn't have to be written down. You know, it's, I mean, we do a lot of things that aren't written down. You know, that, you know, I know, for instance, Bill. He prepares, you know, early in the week. That's not written down. He prepares early in the week. But, you know, if you were to ever do a biography of Bill, you'd probably, you know, have to include that. You know, that he's at it early, working on the next sermon. But you also see that that third point, that there's many steps. One view is that each of these sort of measures one of those many steps as Israel is returning from the captivity. So they were, remember the Babylonians came in, Nebuchadnezzar came in at 587 or 586 BC, and he tore the temple. He didn't actually, I mean, the they tore Jerusalem down, they threw the wall down, and then they took Israel into captivity. And they were for 70 years in this captivity. And then they were returning under Cyrus. Cyrus, the king of Persia. Persia has now beat up on Babylonia. In fact, 539 B.C., the Persians snuck into Babylon and wiped the place out. And so the Persian king, Cyrus, is allowing Israel now to come back. It's about 530 B.C. He allows them to come back. So is this 15 steps as they're going and returning? Maybe this is. You know, again, it's not real clear in the historical record. I think the best explanation that I read is that the Psalms, the Sent, were really sung as the Israelites came to Jerusalem for those three annual returns, that they would come to Jerusalem. They would sing these songs. They might be in groups. They would be by families, maybe several families from a town, and they're returning to Jerusalem for those different feasts. There were three feasts they were returned for. And so they would sing these songs at different points of the journey. Okay? And I think that's the best explanation that I bring you to. I'm not saying the others aren't accurate, but I think the best one is that we see that. So we may be looking at the first Psalm, 120, the first of the 15, kind of the number one Psalm as they set out. These were all designed for vocal music as well, so they would be singing these. So can you picture these groups of Israelites as they're coming to Israel? They think there was about 2.5 million Israelites that were coming into Jerusalem. So there would be well over 1 million people in Jerusalem for these feasts as they return. Can you see these pockets of people coming from all over Israel, walking along the road? It would take them a week, you know, perhaps, to get there. I guess if you lived in Bethlehem and you were close to Jerusalem, you probably felt like, good, we don't have too far to go, you know. And they might have only sung about 4 of them, you know, as they're on their way. So we don't know exactly how they did this, but you would hear the singing. Wouldn't that be beautiful? Hear the singing as the Israelites were coming into the temple, or coming up to the temple for worship. So our last point there, Psalm 120, is also very similar to Psalm 52. And they believe, therefore, that David is the writer of 120. So it's, again, it's not named. It doesn't say a Psalm of David. It's kind of up for grabs. There are psalms that clearly say a Psalm of David. This is not one of them. But it looks so similar to Psalm 52 that they kind of figured that this is written by David. And possibly about difficulties that he had, because this psalm is loaded with difficulties. This psalm is all about lies and deceit. And we're going to see that here right now. So let's take a look at the psalm. Let's look at Psalm 120. I'm going to ask you guys to read out loud. Who would like to read the first 2 verses? Anybody volunteer for that? Psalm 120? 1 and 2? Okay, Betty? How about 3 and 4? Someone read that? And then we need 5 through 7. Okay, 3 and 4, Darlene, and 5 through 7. 5 through 7. Okay, I'll read 5 through 7. Okay.
In my distress, I cried to the Lord, and he heard me. He delivered my soul. Deliver my soul, O Lord, from lying lips and from a deceitful tongue.
Okay,
and
verse 3 and 4.
What have we given to you, or what shall be done to you, you false tongue? The sharp arrows of the warrior, the cold of the groom tree.
Woe is me, that I sojourn in Meshach, that I dwell in the tents of Kedar. My soul hath long dwelt with him that hateth peace. I am for peace, but when I speak, they are for war. So I looked at this. I probably read this psalm many times? More than 10 times. Looking at it, studying it, kind of thing. And at first I thought, I looked at verse 1 and 2, wow, he's crying unto the Lord, and he hears him. That's great news that God hears me. When I cry unto the Lord, he hears me. That should be good news for all of us. That's the most positive thing in this song. You know, number one, verse 1, God hears me when I call to him. But notice it says, in my distress, I call upon. So there's a distress that's come upon him. And he calls on the Lord. But he hears me. God hears me when I call upon him. And then I looked at that second verse. Deliver me, deliver my soul, O Lord, from lying lips and from a deceitful tongue. And so I thought, okay, so looks to me like he's asking God to deliver him from his lying lips and deceitful tongue. That he has lied, that he has been a deceiver somehow. And so on Monday night, that's what I was thinking. I was in front of a group, and that's why I taught. I taught this little thing. I think here's a psalm where he's calling on to God. He's distressed because he has lied. And he has a deceitful tongue. Okay? And then during the week, as I kept reading this, my mind changed. I don't think he's talking about this, his own deceitful lips, his own lying tongue. I think someone is lying about him. Someone is deceiving people about him. And he's got this irritation, this annoyance, this oppression that people are saying bad things about him that aren't true. So he's saying, God, deliver me from those lying lips. Deliver my soul from that deceit. And as you read further, it makes more sense that way. And as you read further and you look at David's life, he had people lying at him. He had people deceiving him. And it does match up a lot with Psalm 52 that we know is David, and it's a similar situation. And so I shifted during the week from this is David's frustration that he's a liar or that he deceives, and it shifted to he's being lied to. He's being lied about, and people are oppressing him. And I began to think how, this is something almost, in some ways, it's like one of us coming into church on Sunday, or several of us coming in, and we just feel oppressed. Maybe you've been in a job during the week, and people are lying about you. I have that happen in work. And you just feel oppressed. You feel worn down. You kind of walk into church, I need you guys. I need to be with God's people. I need refreshment. I've been worn out during the week. Anybody feel like that the world is out there pressing you into its mold? The world is trying to make you think the way the world does? Or, I feel that way sometimes when I get on the internet. And I'm going through these messages. I just feel like I'm getting the world's narrative on all this stuff. On Black Lives Matter, on the environment, I'm just getting this narrative that's pressing me. One day Marcy said, John, I just feel overwhelmed with all these problems. And I'm thinking, okay, well, 50 years ago, 40 years ago, we didn't feel that way. All those things were out there, but you didn't carry them on your back. You weren't thinking about what was going on in South Africa and Egypt and what's going on in Alabama. You were thinking about Albuquerque and your neighborhood or, this thing. But now it's so big. It's like this, all this stuff. And it's the narrative that the news media gives you. You know? It's that. You know, I mean, there are people who are writing the narrative, mm-hmm. and they're putting... And so, if they're lies, or if they're deceiving us or me, you know, that can be very oppressive. You come to a thought, Lord, I need refreshment. I need mm-hmm. your perspective. What's God's perspective? Well, one of the things that we know is the kingdom of God is set against the kingdom of this world. Right. You know, the world, the flesh, and the devil are all working to wear us down and get us to run up a white flag and say, I give up. I'm going to be an ineffectual Christian. I'm just going to go back to my house and just me and Jesus. You know? Mm-hmm. I'm not going to reach out. I'm not going to try to bless other people. It's not worth it. I get clobbered every time I do it. I get oppressed every time I reach out. They take it a different way. They don't listen to, you know, whatever it is. And at work, wow, work can really hammer a person. You know, you can really get hammered. You can have a hostile boss. You can have, so we come in, it's like, I need you, Lord. I need the body. I need one another. I need the encouragement that comes from one another. I feel that way. And I'm not even out there getting hammered that much. I mean, it's like, okay, we're not getting hammered like the Israelites. You know, look what the Egyptians were doing to those Israelites. Talk about getting hammered, you know, every day. Make more bread. Work harder. You know, we're going to leave your babies out to die. You know, we can't, you know, I mean, look at how the culture can oppress you. Our culture is not like that. But it is in many ways. Mm-hmm. You know, the world is always set against God's kingdom. And we are called to what? Live above that. Through the Holy Spirit, through the Spirit who lives in us, we have the power of God working. Amen? I mean, mm-hmm. isn't that right? So look, he says, deliver. He comes to God. Deliver my soul, O Lord, from lying lips and a deceitful tongue. Then in verse 3 and 4, he says, what shall be given unto thee? In other words, he's thinking about what am I going to do to these lying lips and deceitful tongues? I know I'm going to shoot them. I'm going to ask God to shoot them with arrows. Verse 4, sharp arrows of the mighty. God, your piercing arrows. Take care of them. Don't we feel like sometimes we think, God, just take care of these guys, you know? In love, God, kill these guys. Isn't that loving them in the spirit, right? No. We can't ask him. But we want God's arrows to pierce hearts, to change them, to change their thinking, to change that situation. We're not asking God, kill these guys. We're saying, God, send your sharp arrows to pierce hearts. Open up their minds to the gospel. You know, I'm praying that with people around in my neighborhood. You know, God, open their minds. I was praying that for you guys, for me today. You know, God, open our minds to the gospel. Open our hearts. Bear us. Bear our hearts, God. Bless Bill as he gives that sermon. Bless the worship. God, open our hearts to the reality of your kingdom. You know, that's kind of, I feel like this is what he's saying here. So he says, verse 3, what shall be given unto thee? He's speaking about these lying lips, these deceitful people. Or what shall be done unto thee, thou false tongue? Sharp arrows of the mighty with coals of juniper. Okay. So the coals of juniper, or the broom tree, I think whoever read that, I forget. Arlene had broom tree in it. Broom tree, juniper, same thing. It's a tree that grows in the Middle East. And when it burns, it doesn't crackle and pop. It burns very hot and it burns a long time. So what burns very hot and a long time?
The dream tree.
Yeah. And it's a picture, it's a symbol of health, judgment. Lord, put them under your judgment. Pierce them with arrows. And Lord, your judgment, your wrath may be hot and it may be a long time. He's calling down. You know, he's asking God to judge them. Judgment for this deceitfulness. Now, this makes me kind of wonder, you know, I'm looking at this, I'm thinking, so is lying and deceit that important to God? That he would call down God's judgment? That he would say, open up their heart with arrows? Is lying that big a deal? Or am I wrong? And is lying a big deal to God? Well, you look at Revelation. Revelation talks about liars being thrown into what? Lake of fire. Right? In Galatians, lying is listed as one of the great sins. The works of the flesh. And then it talks about the fruit of the Spirit, the works of the Spirit. But there's that flesh. So I think sometimes we look at, it's a little white lie. It's just a little white lie. Because we justify things. What do we call that? We rationalize things. We put up with a lot of things that a holy, pure, righteous God who stands for truth, who is truth, in him there's no imperfection. There's no, nothing off. Pure. He probably looks at those little white lies a little different. You know, there was a guy who went to a funeral and with his wife and they walking along and they saw a headstone and it said, "Here lies who so and so." And he was a politician, a mayor. He was a, here lies so-and-so, an honest and good man. And he turns to his wife and says, honey, it's amazing. There's two people buried in that grave. The mayor and somebody else. An honest and a just man. You don't think of politicians being honest or necessarily just, do you? But God wants us to be honest. He wants our lips to be pure. Let's look at verse 5. So then he says, woe is me that I sojourn in Meshech and dwell in the tents of Kedar. Well, this was very confusing to me. What is Meshech? What is Kedar? Well, they're actually locations. And Meshech is way up. Way far away from Israel, up near where the Assyrians used to live. So he's, did David ever live in Meshech or Kedar? No. But they're way far away. An ungodly people lives there. And then Kedar is way down in near Saudi Arabia. It's in the Arabian Peninsula. Again, outside of Israel. So he's saying, God, I live among people who are ungodly. I'm far away from you, where I live. I'm far away from your temple. I'm far away from there. And my neighbors, the people around me, are afflicting me. I live here and here. Now, how can you live here and there? So you can't. You can't live in two places at the same time. He never lived in either place. But it's kind of symbolic there. He said, I live in these two ungodly places. Woe is me. Now this is that, we would call it sort of an extreme term for sinfulness, for God's judgment woe is me. That's the, it's like I'm undone. I'm undone. I live in this culture that, you know, is oppressing me constantly. So here's another real picture of living in an ungodly culture. He says, my soul hath long dwelt with him who hates peace. I am for peace. I am for it. But when I speak, therefore. In other words, there's always a opposition. There's always conflict. I stand for the Lord, and they always come back. I stand for peace. I stand for loving. No, they're for war. So there's always this conflict. Woe is me. I live in this type of situation. And God, intervene. Shoot your arrows. God, bring your judgment. Change things. That's what he's saying. God, change things. And so, let's take a look at one person who evaluated this. He said in verse 1 and 2, this is Matthew Henry. This is one of the Bible, one of my favorite people to read, actually. He says, and here's where he calls on God to deliver him from false tongues, lies, and deceit. And now, one of the things we ought to see right away there is that God must be totally opposite those lies, deceit, and false tongues, because he's calling on God to deliver him from them. So God stands for truth, not lying, not being deceitful. So I looked at that and I thought, wow, this is a big deal. John, is there any way you lie to people or deceiving them? You know, is there any way that you are, you know, not true? You're not straight. You're crooked. And God, take the crook out of my life. Mm-hmm. Whatever that is. If I tend to soften things, you know, show that to you. Help me. Because you, God, stand for truth. God, deliver me from those lies, those times. So there is a personal application. It's not just looking at your culture and saying, oh man, there are a bunch of liars out there. I think there is a lot of lying. But it's, is that pressing me into the mold? Or am I walking truthfully? Then he goes a little further. He says in verse, I don't have verse 3 or 4 there, but number 2. He threatens judgment of God against falsehood. So he calls to God, open up hearts. Bring your judgment. Show these people. Bring revival. Huh? Cause your gospel to go in there and change hearts. I was once just like that, and you changed me. God, change my neighbor. God, show. You know, so he's calling upon God to intervene. And then number 3, here's verses 5 through 7. I'm sorry, I forgot to put those on there today. He complains of his neighbors who are quarrelsome and annoying. Woe is me. I live in Meshach. I'm in the tents of Kedar. I feel like I'm so distant. My neighbors are so distant from walking with you, God. So in a very real sense, can you see people walking toward the temple? They're going up to Jerusalem. And they're saying, God, remove from me what lying lips. See, I've been in a city or my life has been, it's been tough these last 3 months. You know, whatever. You know, I feel like I live in Kedar. You know, I don't, but I feel like it. And I'm coming in, God, work. As we come into your presence, as we move toward Jerusalem. And so in a real sense, this psalm really hits the nail on the head. We need refreshing. We're like that guy, oh God, I yearn for your courts. I want to know you. And I want to see you. We want you to be at work. Refresh us. You know, it made me think to those three annual trips that Israel made each year. That's why did God have them do that? Anybody think? Yeah, Greg. Oh, I'm sorry. Your hand was on the camera. I'm sorry. But you had it up. Why did God have them come? Why do you think? I mean, you know, we're not all Bible scholars right here. I don't feel like I'm a Bible scholar. But why do you think? Why would God take Israel and command them to come to Jerusalem three times a year?
To refresh them.
To refresh them?
Yeah, to get them back on target.
Get them on target. I like that. I'm going to put that up here. Yeah. So our assembly that we see here for Israel, refresh them, get on target, right? What would get them on target coming to Jerusalem? Russ, what do you think?
Well, I think it's just, I look at God as the great reconciler. That's like his will, you know. And batteries need recharging.
Yeah. Gonna give them a recharge. I like that. That's a good picture, isn't it?
Well, they're looking at the temple, because they're coming to the temple.
Yes.
And so they once again, they get their eyes back on God. You know, getting on target once again, getting their eyes on worship.
Off their problems. It's like a little retreat, isn't it? You're stepping out of your mundane time. You're coming in. You're getting refreshed. You're getting recharged, right? You're getting reconciled. You know, here's all these people here, and the focus is on the Lord. The focus is on worship. It's on the temple. It's on God's purpose. You know, that's what they're talking about. What is God's purpose for us? We're his people. We're coming into Jerusalem. We are different from all the other people. We're dropping what we do, and we move on. You know, last October, I felt like I had an experience a bit like that. Bill and Alpha and Greg and Linda and Marcy and I went out to Kansas City for just like 2-3 days. We went to the prayer room at International House of Prayer. Oh, man. Just talk about sitting there in the presence of God and the worship music going on. And it's like, wow, it was refreshing and it was good. It's made me want to do that more.
Right.
Take a break and get away from the, hey, whatever it is that's kind of a stress, focus on God and go back in.
You know, we need to be, get recharged or refilled in order for us to pour out. You can't pour out if you're empty.
Yeah, absolutely. So this really speaks to me, you know. This also speaks to me daily, right? I need recharge. I need to be before God daily. I need to reach. I need to take that quiet time. I need to meditate on His Word, right? So we got a few lessons here from Psalm 120, and I think you could put up here. And I think you can transfer these. You know, these are the lessons. These are, you know, we need God's people. We need to realize, we need to draw apart. We need to see that the culture and the people around us are oppressing. It's trying to force us into its fold. Now see, it's so subtle, we miss it sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
It's so subtle, you know? Yeah. It's just, you know, the world, the flesh, and the enemy, the devil, are really active. A deceit would be to think, oh, no, I can stand up. I'm good. I don't need Bible study. I don't need to be in the Word every day. I can miss church now and then, maybe more than now. God's made me strong. I've got the Holy Spirit. I can just stand up. That's somewhat true, but we need one another. So that's the other side. Do not forsake your assembly You know, now see, am I preaching to the choir right now? All of you guys have come, right? So this is the choir, right? Here's the choir director right here. Now we're all here, but you know, I need to realize that I still need that refreshment. So a couple things I see. Number one, I see the psalm as a preparation for worship. How? Because I'm drawing apart, I need refreshment, I need to see that, yeah, there's been oppression, there's lying lips, there's deceit, that God, I'm moving now toward your what? Your presence, your worship, and we're all doing it together. All of this comes together. Isn't that great?
Yeah.
It's neat that God made that a requirement. It wasn't a suggestion. It wasn't a suggested scripture to learn. It was a required scripture. Gotta go. Gotta do it. Number two, to call on the Lord. Oh, God. See, it's not, you know, when you're going through things, we gotta call on the Lord. It's not a show of, I'm not strong enough, or I'm not spiritual. No. Here's a spiritually strong group calling on the Lord. Right? So don't feel like you go through something that's wild and unusual. No. The stuff you go through is just like, it's common to man. You know, there's a passage in the Bible that says that, that the struggle is common to man. Next one, number three, we're called to be in the fight. See, it's not a call to be just completely withdrawn. We're not called to the monastery. We're called to be in the fight. We're to carry his glory into the culture. We're to share the gospel. So we need refreshment, you know? And number four, we have to really set his word as a priority. See, God's word is the main way that he speaks to us. I was looking at Psalm 119, 176 verses. Talking about God's word, his ordinances, his statutes, his commands, his decrees, his word. I mean, they use a lot of different terms for his word. Do you realize that 172 verses talk about God's word out of 176? There's a rich, rich passage for us. You know, just read a few of those verses, his statutes, his commands. You know, take time to let God's word sink in. It will change your what? Perspective. And he will speak to us. So you might do that by the priority. Maybe it needs to be a quiet time. Maybe you really need that. Number two, though, or B, how else could you set his word as a priority? You could memorize part of it, right? You could take a little scripture card. You know, I don't have mine with me, but here's a little scripture card. I'm memorizing that. Stick it in your pocket. Stick it in your purse. You know? Look at it 3-4 times a day. Try to. What does that do? You're meditating on God's word. You're learning his word. Number three, what else could you do?
Listen to it.
Listen to it, yeah. Lord, how are you speaking to me? How do I apply this to me? How does this apply to the church? Kind of like just reading Psalm 120. God, how does this apply to me? Listen to his voice. Listen to him. Be quiet before the Lord. Well, Lord, we just thank you that we can study this together. I just thank you, Father, that you've given us your word. And Father, just prepare us for worship as we realize we've come in from conflict, from oppression. Lord, there's been lies. There's been deceit. There's deceit out there that says, hey, it doesn't matter if you're worshiping or not, you know. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if you go to church every Sunday. It doesn't matter if you're in the Word each day. It doesn't matter if you love people. You can slip up. You're okay. Lord, help us to listen to your truth, God. And prepare us now, Lord. We just offer ourselves, Lord, to worship you. Bless Betty, the worship team. Bless Bill. Bless Pastor Greg as the Word is proclaimed. Father, may your Spirit just minister to many hearts, Father. We just lift ourselves to you, Lord, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, thank you all for the encouragement of being here. We're right on schedule, so you can head on into the worship center or fellowship a bit if you like.